Okay, so hi everyone. Thank you for your patience. And thank you for this opportunity. Thank you, Stephen and Toby and Simone and everyone involved in helping me get here. By way of introduction, my name is Taisha Padgett, gender pronouns she, her, hers, they, them, theirs. I do not identify as a First Nations person, an Indigenous person. I'm a Black folk. I came from Cheryl Yvonne McGee and her mother and father, Mildred McGee and Robert Jackson, and my father, Arvell Padgett, and his parents, Ida Lee Dansby and Arvell Padgett Sr. And my grandparents were born in Louisiana and Alabama and were part of the Great Migration to California, to the west, to the north, to the east, just out of the south. And that is as much as I know. So I say sometimes when people ask me about where I came from, I say that, well, when a young girl or someone who identifies, someone who was born with a womb is born, they're born with all of the eggs, all the reproductive eggs that they will have for the rest of their lives. So my mother, when my mother was in her mother, she had the cells, the eggs that would make me. So if anything, I've come from my grandmother. So I guess there's a question as to why I'm here. And I've been really interested in these questions of land and indigeneity. And I also feel that in this perspective, from the perspective of the United States, right now I feel like there are two really pivotal epochs that we're in, and that is the epoch of Black Lives Matter and Standing Rock. And I'm really just asking really speculative questions as to what happens when we bring these, when we allow these conversations and histories and practices of resiliency to intersect. I also have been just thinking about institutions and being in the art world and how one's work moves, has a capacity to migrate. My work has moved into Canada, into Toronto, into Vancouver, and in doing so, it's got me asking these interesting questions or different questions about land. And so I'm here very much in this place of researching, and I don't really know, I've got a lot of things up here, I'm not sure what makes sense to share, because I'm just really in this place of asking really broad questions. I ask for your patience with my thought process as much as my technology skills. And I'm gonna be reading from some text that I wrote back and forth, so bear with me too as I kind of play with this world and that world. I was going back through this, the provocation, the theme of groundworks, and rereading, going over and over this prompt, exploring connections to place and founding place, founding practices, grounding in land, voice and language, reconnecting to and nurturing traditions, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And all of these things, to answer that question, I feel the first thing I want to do is play for you a short bit of text from Malcolm X from 1963. To contextualize this question of what it means to have a relationship to land from the perspective of Black American identity, the racial identity of Black America.
To understand this, you have to go back to what young brother here referred to as the house Negro and the field Negro. Back during slavery, there was two kinds of slaves. There was the house Negro and the field Negro. The house Negro, they lived in the house with master. They dressed pretty good. They ate good because they ate his food. Because he left. They lived in the attic or the basement, but still they lived near their master. And they loved their master more than the master loved himself. They would give their life to save their master's house quicker than the master would. The house Negro, the master said, we got a good house here. The house Negro said, yeah, we got a good house here. Whenever the master said we, he said we. That's how you can tell a house Negro. If the master's house caught on fire, the house Negro would fight harder to put the blaze out than the master would. If the master got sick, the house Negro would say, what's the matter, boss? We sick. We sick. He identified himself with his master more than his master identified with himself. And if you came to the house Negro and said, let's run away, let's escape, let's separate, the house Negro would look at you and say, man, you crazy. What you mean separate? Where is there a better house than this? Where can I wear better clothes than this? Where can I eat better food than this? That was that house Negro. In those days, he was called a house nigger. And that's what we call him today, because we still got some house niggers running around here.
So that speech by Malcolm X was given in 1963, shortly after the March on Washington, which if you look at some images, you'll probably recognize, which he deemed as kind of like a missed opportunity in the middle of some building momentum in the civil rights movement. He called it somewhat of a publicity stunt. And we can go into the content of the speech as it relates to what was happening in American history at that time. But what I'm interested in is this notion of black identity through the kind of filter of these two spaces, the house, the space of the house, and the space of the field. And it's this kind of psychogeography that brings me to these questions about land, and I'm interested in how those questions come up for me in my work, and how my work can be, and art making in general, can be an opportunity to speak back, to reclaim, to think about building some resiliency from the trauma of displacement. So I absolutely invite you to ask a question if something comes up, because I am skipping around. So I want to just talk about how I thought about engaging land and work, land and space in my own work. And I'll say in the past, I think that the bigger framework that I've had for my work is thinking about it being having a conversation with the dance world. So I started as a dancer. I started late, dancing at the age of 20-ish. And in doing so, entered into this experience of taking classes. First of all, enjoying just like the bliss of moving as someone who was shy and not really able to, having had issues with a lot of communication, I found the dance studio to be the site of possibility. But then in being choreographed into a lot of dance works, I found also it was a space in which these identities of heteronormativity and very normative sense of life and living get kind of practiced. And so entering into dance, as a dancer, dance became a space in which I got politicized. And so in my work, I started asking questions about identity and also what it means to undo the dance space and instead think of dance dance space as this broader field in which power relations can be turned upside down. For me, as a performer, to think about land, to think about placemaking, is to think about time. And so in my work, I also got into a practice of, you know, what we call like kind of institutional, like kind of the art canon wants to just call it endurance work. But for me, I found inside of creative practice a way to occupy space for an extended period of time, to have this kind of momentary utopia in which I could claim a sense of land and create a sense of belonging for myself. This work I created in 2009, and it was at the invitation of a show by artist-curated projects in Los Angeles, and this was a show that was in a house by someone who had just moved in and was empty and wanted people to mark space. And I didn't know, this is the first time I did this work using regular crayons. There's a crayon theme here, that his walls were permanently marked with the wax. So sorry, Eric Kim, for that. But the work, I've also done this piece at the Studio Museum in Harlem, Centrophy in Montreal, and in Philadelphia. And this version of it was 3 hours. Other versions have gone between 3 and 5 hours. The other reason why I'm starting to ask these questions about land in my work is really trying to get at asking these questions about land and these questions of what it means to think about Black identity through this filter of indigeneity is because I have been hinting at land and place in my work, but in ways that are kind of sideways, and I'm just at a place of wanting to take it to another level. So this work here that you're seeing is from a project called School for the Movement of the Technicolor People. And in this project, I first started in a process of creating a dance company. So instead of bringing a group of people together to kind of be anonymous bodies to fulfill my work, we decided to call ourselves a dance company, and that dance company was called, or is called, WXPT, or We Are the Paper, We Are the Trees, which is also kind of pointing to land being the organic matter and the byproduct of land, paper and trees. And we set this as a group of 16 people, 16 plus myself, who would work together and engage in rehearsal practice and build dance for 1 year. It was a one-year company in the form of an intentional community. And we worked together and built, we'd have rehearsals outside, and through our practice of rehearsing, which was grounded in thinking about contact improvisation. Are there any dancers in the house? Yes. So, from this postmodern Western white dance canon, we are relying on contact improvisation, which is this form that relies on weight exchange and kind of bringing the two kind of geographical land masses of a body together to move in contact as a way to build a physical exchange. And so from our rehearsal practices, we try to figure out what would be the next stage. What does a dance company do next? And so we created this school. It was a 6-week dance school, and this dance school was situated within a gallery. This is LACE, Los Angeles Contemporary Exhibitions in Los Angeles. This project was also done in Houston at Diverse Works. And it was not only about trying to kind of prod and kind of extend the limits of, kind of push the limits as to how much a gallery can hold a body, especially as the body of performance are very kind of hot right now. It was also about kind of imagining this space of possibility. And here, so you can't see so clearly in this image, but the space is created by this carpet that covers the walls, and it's kind of imagined as that the image is as if the carpet is kind of sliding up the walls, kind of migrating through space. And cut into the center is what would typically be a dance floor, but it's made on a, instead of being a typical rectangle, it is a parallelogram, which I consider to be a queer shape that is in this place of falling and rising. And as a dancer, to move across the floor without a right angle itself is a bit disorienting, so I was trying to think about a way to shift people's relationship to the space. One of the things I'm also really grappling with is this notion of a fugitive body, this notion of the slave, the body that escapes its enclosure. And so one of the actions of Lace was not only to put a hole in the ground and in the wall, not only to create this kind of imaginary pathway for a fugitive body, but to also kind of get at this kind of anxiety around the absence of a sense of land, home, etc., and almost kind of breaking through these institutional walls as a way to try to find some kind of foundation. This is the version. And the other thing I'll say just about the materials, we chose, myself and my collaborators, chose the brown carpet as a way to kind of not only conjure up a sense of like dirt, earth, land, but also the skin of the black body, and to think of the carpet itself as a type of skin. These panels here were kind of like an imagined, the mirror of a dance studio kind of taken and broken into a billion pieces, and then turned into these objects that can be carried, so they themselves become bodies. And instead of having a regular reflective surface, we chose a black plexiglass, and using black, the reflection of the idea of a black reflection, to conjure these ideas of unlearning and the history of the black mirror. So not only was it was this about cutting into the space as a way of kind of trespassing and place making, then the question is then what happens? Well, then it becomes a space for home, for bodies, for these bodies of color that are the community to occupy. For this one moment in time to treat as a place that is their home. And so these dance classes happen in this space. This is a smaller version that happened in Austin, Texas. And alongside this occupation of space, we are engaging in movement practices and talking about histories, different dance histories, and different ways, talking about the different ontologies that we carry in our bodies. My time is up, but I just want to show you one other kind of strand of work. And that is this work, Counts Orchestrates a Meadow. Counts Orchestrates a Meadow, the practice of breath, is a work that I did at the ICA in Philadelphia. It's to work in contemporary art. If the internet will allow it. In this work, this idea of a meadow, this idea of a meadow has also been in my work. So I think to think about land is broad and maybe even a little problematic. So instead, I've been thinking instead about this idea of a meadow. And on one like really basic level, you can think of the meadow as another way of talking, another way of pointing to the dance studio. But I'm trying to think of the meadow more broadly as it relates to, again, thinking about how bodies on the margins come to find agency. So this idea of what it means to create a meadow, I was just writing some thoughts down that I'll share. And this work, Counts Orchestrated Meadow, it's myself and Mina Marugasan, a South Asian identified queer dancer. And it is a 30-minute piece that we perform 3 times in a row. And in it, we are thinking very much about what I think about of this inverted virtuosity of being deflated bodies and allowing ourselves to merge with the architecture of the room and the bodies in the space as a way to kind of get into inside of this land mummy and also contemplate this idea of violence against black and brown bodies by ourselves merging with these forms. And outside of what you might not be able to see is, though we're moving, merging with, in the middle of this space is this white field, again, carpet, this time white instead of brown, and that is the meadow. And it's given in the space not only as a kind of backdrop for our performance, but also an offering of softness in the context of the kind of art interior of this gallery, of this museum space. So as I'm thinking about this idea of the meadow and as it will continue to show up in my work, I say the meadow, not just a dance studio, but a site of possibility, not just a dance studio, but a necessarily impossible space, not just a stage, but a queer space, an imaginary space, a space that can only be imagined, a space outside of time, a fugitive space, something of the outdoors, or less romantically, the out-of-doors, a space which resists enclosure, quoting Hartman and Milton, a state of being outside, a political location, a state of inhabitants, where the field Negro resides, an ecologically minded space, the stage studio reimagined, the hood, my vacant corner lot, the broken parking lot, all of these can be a space of possibility. So the video doesn't want to play, but my time is up. Anyways, I hope that was useful. Thank you for listening.